Brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Also brought to you by BF Goodrich Tires, who asks, are you driver enough? This week on Auto Restomont, Benny is back to help me finish the stereo in the 69 Fairlane, and we finally go boom.
National Parts Depot is proud to offer these alloy wheels for your classic Ford. The wheels offer clean, original styling, while sizes from 15x7 to 17x8 inch allow for a greater selection in modern performance tires. Check out National Parts Depot for Mustang and Cougar, Camaro and Firebird, Chevelle and GTO, Ford Truck and Bronco, Chevy Truck, Mopar, and Thunderbird. At our four locations, we stock the largest selection of classic car parts anywhere. Visit us at nationalpartsdepot.com or call us at 888-893-FAST.
Oh no.
Wow, that's really small.
Oh, you mean the tire?
The tire.
Yeah, well, I thought you were talking about something else.
Is that for the wagon?
Yeah, actually it is. See, what happens is that once you start doing one thing, you have to do something else in order to make the thing work. So, you can't put the subwoofer where we want to put it and have a normal size spare. So I went to the salvage yard and got a Space Saver spare out of an Aerostar, which is the same bolt pattern as most classic Fords, to put this back there where the regular spare is supposed to sit. We also won't have a jack anymore either, because the subwoofer, well, anyway, I'll talk about that later.
Let's hope you never need that.
What is that?
Oh yeah, Gina said you wanted this.
I don't really want it. But we have had a viewer write in and say that he would like to see an episode on how to restore one of these. So conveniently, since we have this one from your car and we don't need it anymore, we'll just rebuild it and we'll throw that sucker out on eBay.
Hey, that viewer, once it's done.
Maybe. He might want it more than we do. All right, we'll go put it with all the other junk, and I'm going to put this in the back. Okay, now I've got on the table some of the needful things you're going to have whenever you're putting one of these systems together. Now, a lot of times we'll go through and do solder connections. I'm not doing that on this one. I'm actually going to go over how to use connectors to put the system together. First thing I want to talk about, though, is what to use whenever you're setting up your wires. I've got two tools here, and I ended up using both of these to do this. I have a normal cutter with a crimp tool. This is really much more handy whenever you're doing a lot of crimping work. If you've got stuff like most of your stereo gear is going to come with everything already cut at the end and soldered down. This will make it a lot easier to put your crimps together. But if you do need to go in and surgically remove the ends of the casings for the wires, a set of things like this KD will work really well. The thing I don't like about the KDs is your crimping tool is back behind here, so it's kind of awkward to have to open up the legs of the crimping tool and then go in and crimp those ends. The next thing I'm going to talk about is something that I ordered, and that is these 3.5 connectors. And basically why I ordered these, if you can see it, we have a nut on the end of this. This can actually now be panel mounted to somewhere on the car. I like this a little bit better than just having those 3.5 jacks hanging down up underneath the dash or trying to find another place to put them. This will allow us to put them somewhere on the dash panel to make this work a little bit better. Next to that, I have a power lug. I'm going to show you a little bit about that later on, but you'll definitely want to get one of these if you're going to be putting a lot of electrical components in a classic car. Simply put, they were not designed to have a ton of electrical components on them. Now, next up, what I'm going to talk about is connectors. Now, one of the things I'll tell you is when you're doing wire connectors, make sure you get the right size connector for the wire you're working with. For instance, we're doing a lot of 14 to 16 gauge wire in the car, but our speaker wire is not. It's probably 18 to 20. So what I've got here is these are 14 to 16 connectors, and these are 18 to 20 connectors. And you'll want to have these depending on what the wire size is on the car. This is the ring terminals that we will be using with our 5/16 power lug, and these are also set up with a nice weatherproofing on them. You can take this and shrink wrap that down to the connector, and it'll seal everything off, make it work really nice. Now, last week, we were using our test light to find out if we had a 12-volt connection. What I'm going to tell you right now is that's really not going to work for you this week. This week, what we're going to be dealing with is trying to make sure we have a full 12 volts at both of the locations that we needed to hook up for inside the car to operate the radio.
So what we're going to want to do is we're going to want to use a nice multimeter to make sure that we have a good 12 volts. We had a viewer write in saying he was having a lot of problems with his RetroSound radio not operating correctly, that the sound was choppy coming out of the speakers, which told me he probably had an electrical problem rather than a radio problem. Sure enough, he went through, worked through the system, made sure he had a good solid 12 volts to the radio, and guess what? The radio now operates correctly. So make sure you don't blame the radio first. Make sure you look at your classic 50-year-old or 40-year-old car for the problem rather than blaming the radio initially, because like I said, that's what he thought he had a problem with. Moving on. Okay, now we've got our fresh battery in here. We put a Group 27F because we wanted that extra oomph that we could possibly get from the 27F. We've gone in and wired up both our subwoofer and our amp using the same size wire that comes in the kit. Now with our wagon, because we're a little bit longer than a lot of the other cars you're going to run into, we had to add a little bit of wire to it. So inside, we went in and used a couple of GM connectors. Now, the wiring from the guys at RetroSound on the amplifier actually has a Delphi-style connector on it, while the subwoofer does not. So we went in and found a Delphi-style connector that we had in our kit from some of the American AutoWire stuff we did a little while back, and used that to complete our circuit on this. We also changed the style of our fuses on this. One of them was a glass-style fuse, the other was a blade-style fuse. We went blade-style fuse on both of those, and we put them as close as we could to our power lug that we screwed into the apron on the car. That should complete our wiring setup on this thing, and we should be good to go, and it should power right up. That's all I got to say about that. We're going to keep moving forward on the car. Okay, the final out on our little speaker enclosures that we made using the PVC. Now, this is a little different application. A lot of guys have given us some grief about that, and I can understand that. I can understand guys not really being delighted with what they see here. But what we're doing is this is basically going to be our speaker enclosure base. Now, you might be able to see that we've gone in and put some brass cleats around the outside edge. And what that's going to do is that's going to tighten up this when we put the cap back on top of it. Hopefully, if that doesn't work, I'll go in and do something a little different. Now, we're going to take and basically screw this down to the floor with a single sheet metal screw right down the center of it. And then we'll put the cap on top after we go in and make our final hookups with the speakers. And then what we're going to do is we're going to do a little test out to see how these things sound, because one of these we've left unbaffled and the other one we have baffled. So we'll be able to pull them back apart, put the baffling in, because I'm going to go ahead and do all that anyway. But I wanted to do a test out for you guys to see exactly how that works, since some people have questioned our motivation and sanity for actually having done that. So I'm going to go ahead and screw this little bad boy to the floor and then go ahead and start getting the other side done after that. Okay, so we've had people that wrote in and said, you need to separate the bottom and the top of the speaker and everything's going to be awful if you don't. So what we're going to do now is we have our 2 4-1/4s in their little sewer pipe containers on either side of me here in the back seat, exactly where they're going to go when we do the final installation on these here in a little bit. And what we're going to do now is this one is not separated and this one is. So Vinny's going to play some music for us and I'm going to sit here and see if I can tell a difference between the non-separated and the separated. Or is it the non-separated and the separated? Either way, we're going to see if I can tell a difference.
And it's not a sewer pipe, it's ruggedized PVC.
Yes.
You ready?
Yes.
Let's give you a little volume. Tell me, is that a good volume? A little higher?
A little higher.
All right. Can you tell the difference? Let's try a little balance. Hold on a second.
Now what we're going to do is we're going to go back and forth with them.
So there's the left one. All right, let's go over to the right. Now, from where I'm sitting, that one sounds just a skosh bassier.
Actually, that's the one that doesn't have the baffling in it.
Still sounds like it's got just a skosh.
If that's what's supposed to happen, though, is you're supposed to separate them, and then you get more bass out of the system.
I can tell you what it does sound, though.
It's good. Nice. I mean, that's 2 4-1/4s, folks. You may not be able to really tell it listening to it on the show, but I'm telling you right now, it will go really loud!
That's enough.
So what have we proved?
Reptosound makes some pretty nice speakers.
Oh, and by the way, somebody wrote in and said we were going to have a lot of rattle from those speakers. No rattle at all. So, what we've proven here is...
that Reptosound makes pretty good speakers that are installation flexible.
Yes. We can use, what was it you said, ruggedized PVC enclosures?
And one thing I don't think people can appreciate, you know, through the video, it's loud.
It is very loud.
And it's not distorting.
And some of that may be because of the bass blockers, but you were telling me there may be something we need to talk about when we go into the main part of this on how to adjust the system after we get everything hooked up, what needs to be done with the quad four, the subwoofer and all that to get everything where it's talking to each other all nice and pretty. Because there's some setups that you need to do,
it's
right?
It's not so much about talking to each other. It's just about getting everything balanced. You don't want it overwhelming with the bass or the treble when you turn the master volume up. You want balance. And then you can tweak it with your bass and treble controls on the deck.
Cool. So we're going to go over that in just a second. But I'm going to get out of the back seat. And that's going to be hard because we've lit this thing up like Christmas. So I'm going to go out this door.
Sit here and enjoy some music.
I'm leaving.
So I noticed something today while we were doing this installation. The quadraphonic amplifier actually has a built-in crossover at 100 Hz, meaning anything below 100 Hz will get filtered out from the speakers, or you can set it to full, and then the whole frequency range will go to the speakers. Now, we've also got bass blockers in line blocking anything under 600 Hz, so we wanted to do a test and see which do we like better. Is the crossover built into the amplifier sufficient, or do we want to block those frequencies below 600 Hz? So, just like we did with the backseat, I've got both front speakers hooked up. One has the bass blocker in it, and then the other one is just using the crossover that's built into the amplifier, and I want to see if there's any sound difference. So right now I've switched over. This one does not have the bass blocker in it. Now I'll cut over to the right side that does have the bass blocker in line. And I think that sounds a little bit cleaner, so we're going to go ahead and leave those bass blockers in. We'll let the sub handle all the bass for us.
Now somebody made a comment when we first hooked the stereo up. It wasn't very loud. And that was because we hadn't adjusted the amplifier yet, so I'm going to show you how to do that right now. I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to select the rear channel, just using the fader controls right in the deck. I'm going to go all the way to the rear channel. I'm going to wait for it to switch back over so I can control the volume. And the directions in the manual say to turn it up to about 2/3 all the way up. So to me, that's about 27 or 28 on the volume. Things are going to get loud. So the next thing you have to do is adjust the pod on the amplifier until you start to hear a little distortion, and then just back it off a little bit. So you're going to start with it all the way down, turn counterclockwise, and then just turn it so you start to hear distortion, back it off a little bit. Then just do the same thing on the front channel and you're good to go.
All right, I'm going to tell you right now, your sub mounting is going to be subjective. It depends on where you're putting it. In a 60s Ford station wagon, anything Fairlane 1966 through 71, that's a crackerjack spot. And I'll tell you why. Because I am basically using my bumper jack area for my top brace across and the bottom brace. I made some brackets screwed to the outside of the fender well. Actually screw that in with some bolts so it's a good, hard, solid mount. This works really, really well. We've already played around with it a little bit off camera. It so works so well that apparently some of the cabling is quite excited to be here. So what we're going to do now is Vinny's going to go in. He's going to talk to you a little bit about how to go ahead and get this thing wired in, set up, and hooked up. And then we'll basically be done with this episode for this week. So I've done my part and made the mounting brackets. Now Vinny's going to make it sound pretty. Well, good.
Jeff's got the subwoofer mounted in the back of the car. The connections from the subwoofer to the deck are really straightforward. On the deck, you've got cables labeled subwoofer out, and those RCA cables just go directly to the subwoofer. Then you've got the blue wire that actually turns the sub on and off, just like the amplifier. And then you have a power wire that doesn't go to the deck, that goes straight to the battery. Now, the deck is set from the factory with the subwoofer settings off, so I'm going to show you how to turn those on, or you'll be really sad because you won't get any thump out of your subwoofer. So we just push that left button. So when you get to the sub setting, go from off to on. Set your bass to a value other than zero, and we're going to have the sub volume set to 10.
Why not 11?
Okay, 11. Okay, now also from the factory, the subwoofer gain is set all the way down. So I'm going to have Jeff turn that up now. Jeff, can you go ahead and hit that gain?
Working on it.
And you hear a terrific difference in the music.
All right, now I've got a couple things I want to do on this before we go to final mounting, and I may go in and put some isolators on the backside of this sub where I've got it mounted to the bracket. Basically, I just wanted to give you guys an idea of how this thing could mount in a soft or hard mount like this, hard to the chassis. So, Vinny, I guess only one thing left to do.
What's that?
Play some polka music.
All right.
Well, Vinny, what do you think?
Pretty impressed.
I am too, man. I was thinking, you know, 4 1/4 and 5 1/4. Surely we're not going to get a ton of sound out of those.
No, I disagree.
I do too. Holy moly, man, that thing runs nice.
And we were playing with it earlier, and we did not have the sub mounted. We just kind of had it sitting in the back area, and then it's mounted now. World of difference in the sound. I mean, it really sounds just awesome now.
I have a little bracketry problem that I created with the mounting brackets, but I mean, overall, I think if I can tighten those brackets down in the back, that thing's gonna thump.
Yeah.
I'm watching the quarter panel quiver.
Awesome.
Very happy with it. All right, folks, well, that's our show for this week. Now, next we're gonna be coming back with wiring in the 100 amp alternator on this 69 Fairlane. We're adding a lot of stuff to this car that's electrically related, and we need a little more juice for the moose. So, do us a favor and come back and watch us next Thursday on
Auto Restomod.
Have a great week.
Thanks for watching.
Polka!
Polka music, here it comes.
Come on, kids.